Welcome everybody to Online Teaching Tuesdays, week number 3, and we are joining you from two of us in Windsor. You can tell by the two with the same background, although we don't actually have two identical houses or rooms in our house. I'm Bonnie Stewart, and Dave Cormier, who's actually in the basement but has made it look as if he's not in the basement, is with us today. Also, John Schinker in Ohio and Helen DeWaard here in Ontario, and I am going to begin sharing. And we'll just bring up our plan for today. Basically, for anyone who's joined us for Online Teaching Tuesdays before, it's just a drop-in. We're the only ones on screen, so y'all don't even have to do your hairs. But we welcome questions, and we also kind of focus our conversation each week or with different co-hosts around different topics or themes that might be relevant in the middle of this wild online time. One of the big things this week that we wanted to talk about was this idea of, just a second, it's going automatically, I apologize. Sorry. We're not about tools, but about pedagogy. And really what we're focusing on is how do you create meaningful experiences in online spaces? And one of the conversations that we wanted to bring forward today was the idea of digital is different. So many times when people haven't worked a lot in online spaces, particularly as an educator, there is an instinct to go, okay, this is what I do, and I'm going to take this and I'm going to move it into an online compartment. And this tweet from Alice Keeler, I just kind of encapsulate the idea that there is something different about this medium, and there are things that we can do really well in this medium, things that we can actually potentially even meet students' needs better or some of students' needs better, while in other ways, there is definitely a narrowing of capacity. And so with Dave and John and Helen today, we're going to talk a little bit about how that works. Our focus always is the idea of online teaching and keeping it simple, equitable, and engaging. And that is sort of our mantra as when we're going forward. And for me, as I start to redesign everything that I'm going to be doing come August, September, thinking about, okay, am I keeping this as simple as possible for my students who will have 10 courses total at the same time? Am I keeping it equitable for my students who have any variety of not just different learning needs and capacities and accommodations, but also different socioeconomic backgrounds, different language capacities, different devices in their home, different realities because some will be home with small kids during the August summer course and just may not be able to like come together in synchronous time? And am I making it so that their give a hoot factor, their will to engage is something that I'm drawing in and doing as much as I can to foster? I can lead people to water. How can I do that best in a digital space? If you are interested in more on simple, equitable, engaging, there are 3 webinars that we did earlier last month at k12.olaya.ca. But for today, we'll turn it over mostly to John and Helen. So John, why don't you tell us who you are and what you do?
All right. First, thank you for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk with everyone today. My name is John Schinker. I am a technology director for a school district outside of Cleveland. We have about 3,700 students in 5 schools, grades K through 12. I've been in this role for 20 years, kind of overseeing all aspects of technology for the schools, and do a lot of work with the infrastructure side, the making everything work, but also on the instructional side, how does technology affect learning, and how do we make learning better by using technology tools? So it's a really fun kind of role where I get to be a teacher sometimes, and I get to be a tech guy sometimes, and it's really an exciting place to be. So I'm thrilled to be here. Thanks.
Delighted to have you. And one of John's real strengths is that I think he's worked for a long time at that interface of here's education, here's online, how do we put the two together? So I'm hoping that he'll have lots of kind of hands-on examples for us. No pressure.
And My name is Helen DeWaard. My background is K to eight. I've taught kindergarten up to grade eight, everything from, you know, streamed phys ed courses and health to sitting in the circle with the kindergarten students. So I'm now in the higher ed space. I work at Lakehead University in Orillia with a focus on critical media digital literacies. So I'm bringing both camps into play at the same time. I teach online currently, but have taught blended and face-to-face settings and have always used supported scaffolded student learning with technology. So it's nice to see some of the shift that's happening, but I'm hoping that some of the conversations that people are having will help them rethink and that it is different, and the digital brings some of those potentials to light for students and does provide some barriers for others.
It does, and I think that's something that we want to get into today. So I'm going to take the first question and pose it out to folks. And I want to thank everybody who is here and get you to think about your questions and start putting them in the Q&A. But the first thing that I want to pose out to our guests is, how is digital or online teaching different? Helen, you've worked, like you say, K straight through higher ed in all different contexts. I know you think about the digital in terms of literacies. How do you see the digital as significantly different as a learning space?
So for me, I see it very different in terms of student voice and opportunities to speak, particularly for those who may be shy or reluctant, those who are less confident. And making sure that they all have an opportunity to engage, to share, to give themselves time. Digital allows you to give them space. Mm-hmm. You know, it gives you the, as a teacher, the opportunity to let them think about something for a while and then come back. So you time things differently. So it's that flexibility, it's giving a voice, it's giving them different media that they can engage in. So using memes in faculty of ed is a great way to engage them and hook them to create a meme about this particular reading and what's the key piece in it and submit that. So you can use different tools and different technologies and different strategies to get the students to communicate what they know.
I remember being, I guess, at some point when I was studying digital a few years back, and beginning to look at the ways in which the medium of print has kind of had a lot of our cultural concepts of education by the neck for a very long time. And we are acculturated to still see a great deal of both learning and assessment fundamentally at the points where we take it seriously in terms of what print media makes possible. And so sometimes branching out and thinking, oh, having students create a meme rather than write an essay, that can actually be legit learning. It depends on what you're teaching, obviously. But that's interesting. John, how about you?
I just wanted to jump in again and say that it's allowing the students the choice of how they're going to share that. And if some want to make a meme and some want to write, you know, five paragraphs, and some want to be able to just, you know, have a video, do a video montage, and some want to just use audio recording. So it allows them some of those choices that they don't have in a physical classroom necessarily.
Yeah. John, how about you?
So first, some context. One of the things we were talking about before we started recording was that we're in so many different places that, you know, along this journey, it's just very, very different for different people. Some of them are ending a term. Some of them are starting a term. Some people have been out of the classroom for a long time. And so just kind of a little bit of background of where we are right now. We've been we've been learning at home since March 16th, I think. And so we're not going back to the classroom this academic year. We have a couple weeks left in the school year. And so we're going to finish that online. We're going to have our teachers back for a little bit of professional development and prep time for fall. And then in the fall, we're not sure what anything's going to look like yet. We don't know if we're going to be back face-to-face. Best case scenario that we're looking at is we may have kind of a hybrid model where we have half the kids in school at a time so that we can maintain the social distancing and have, you know, 12 or 15 kids in a room at a time. We may have people back for partial days. So that's all very much up in the air. It's still also possible that we may be entirely out. And then there's also that remote idea that we might go back or go back in some sort of hybrid model and then have to go back to an entirely online model. So there's all kinds of things that we're throwing around right now. In terms of online being different from a face-to-face model, one of the things that we've been talking through as we've been preparing for this is looking at scarcity versus abundance and how those are different in online spaces versus face-to-face spaces. So if you look at a face-to-face classroom, the abundant piece is that interaction that you can pull a kid aside and just talk to them. You can put kids into groups very easily. They can go out in the hallway. They've got space and collaboration space. The scarcity is information, right? We set up classrooms, you know, by tradition and sometimes intentionally to be information scarce, right? The kids have to put their phones on the table when they come in, or they have to put their books under their chairs so that they don't have access to information. The teacher is that information resource, and they provide content to kids. When we go shift to online, information's everywhere, right? They have all of that content. They've got another screen right over here, and they've got their phone, and they've got all of these resources. The thing that is scarce is that interaction with individuals and that ability to talk to the teacher one-on-one or to interact with your teacher. So we're really talking about how we leverage the abundance that we have when we have it and how we deal with the scarcity that we have. So we're really talking about models of when you have the kids in the class, don't stand and give them content. They have content in the online environment. Let's focus on how we can connect with them individually, how we can work with them to differentiate instruction to meet their individual needs. And so those are the pieces that we're trying to focus on. So really playing to the strengths of both of the modalities.
As John stole my answer, I will go ahead and make a different point. I think one of the things that changes a great deal inside of the digital space is the power of relationship, right? So you have an intense amount of control over what happens inside of a space. One of the things that we find, so maybe I'll give a bit about my own context right now. I spent the last 5 weeks teaching an intensive course or successive intensive course to different groups of faculty. So it's a 1 week, 5 day course that we're teaching at the University of Windsor. So I've had over 100 faculty go through the course at this point. And they're all faculty we haven't seen before. They're not all of them, but a lot of them are faculty who are, for a variety of reasons, never consider teaching online. Some of whom because, you know, they teach movement or sculpting. And some of whom just are really happy with what they're doing in a face-to-face environment and didn't see the need. But people who are committed to their craft, just people, because they're taking this elective course and coming in and doing what they can to learn, but they've not, they didn't really plan to do this. 6 weeks ago, 8 weeks ago, they had nowhere in their minds that they believe that they're going to be teaching online. But one of the big things that we find is that the power relationship and the sensory cues are very, very different in digital space. So there are ways to teach, to do a live facilitation and find out whether or not people are engaged. There are ways in a live facilitation to be able to keep control over your classroom, but they're very different. So for most people in a face-to-face environment, the social cues, the social contract that they establish is something that everybody knows. Everybody knows that if somebody starts yelling in the middle of the classroom, that it's a breach of social contract. If the teacher is talking and then you talk without, like if you just start talking in the middle of somebody talking, we know that that's a breach of the social contract inside the classroom. We've all spent, you know, at least that 12 years inside of a K-12 environment, in some cases 16 years before, that establishes those things. When we move to a digital space, is it okay to talk in the chat room right now while we're talking? Well, we think it's okay. but I definitely know that there are some faculty who find that frustrating. And also, for both of those issues, both from a power perspective and also from an engagement perspective, so many faculty didn't realize how much they relied on eye contact from their students. Just that simple feedback of being inside of a classroom. And they'd never thought about it because they never had to. I'm not saying they were probably doing a great job with their sensory feedback from students, but suddenly they have to do it in a different way. Now, some of that can be better, right? So for instance, if you do a breakout discussion inside of a classroom and people talk for 15 or 20 minutes, you're only going to get a speckle of what happens in that conversation. But if you do that in a digital space, in a discussion forum, you get all of it, right? And you can get a much richer idea of what happened, but you get all of it. So you got to have a different way of interacting with it. And again, so you can see the engagement does happen. The power structures do exist. There are ways in which to apply, take a different view on the word power, to apply scaffolding that allows the course to develop. But digitally, it has to be renegotiated. And most importantly, I think that the main point that I'm trying to get to here is we have a whole bunch of implicit understandings of scaffolding and engagement in a face-to-face classroom that most people, or a lot of people at least, have never actually worked their way through. In an online, you got to start from scratch. You got to go, okay, what do I care about? And when we ask that question, what's the first thing you do in the first 5 minutes you walk in a class? Almost universally, 10 people of the 20 or 25 in the class say, smile. And I go, great. Now let's talk about what a digital smile looks like. And then people giggle or whatever. And I go, no, seriously. You need to understand how you're going to smile inside of a classroom, because your presence is going to be related to your engagement. It's going to be related to your scaffolding. And it's this, I have to describe how all this works. And it's that piece that I think is the big difference in teaching in digital space.
Even ask them how they're going to smile with a mask on, right? You know, because it's completely different, right?
Yeah, totally.
We've got to smize with our eyes. But it is, like, we've got to think about all of the ways in which we communicate, all of the things that we do that we take for granted, that for the most part, a face-to-face environment doesn't force us to consider at a meta level. And that meta thinking is an important part of most online success. It's a lot of work to do that work, right? There's cognitive load in terms of building that meta thinking. There's also cognitive load in terms of considering how many spaces your students are having to engage with, right? So every time that I've been working in online ed for 20 years, not only can I not fix your computer, I can barely operate my own. I'm like, I do online pedagogy, right? I do not do a great job of the technical ends of online. And so every time I try a new interface, I've got to develop a new password and log in and figure out where the on button is and all of those pieces. And that exhausts me. And the same is true for a lot of teachers and a lot of students, for sure. Go ahead, Helen.
I'm just going to jump in and just come back to a comment that Christine made about personal relationships. And this one goes to that you know, the C model and keeping it really simple. So right now, we've got the advantage that the teachers who are teaching have built a relationship with their students, K-12, higher ed, potentially. You left those physical spaces with that relationship already established. When you go into September, or in my case, you go into a new course, you have to figure out how you're going to build those relationships. And you want that relationship building done within the first 2 or 3 weeks. You have to be very strategic about what kinds of things you want to do with the students in order that they're building relationships with each other, not just with you as the expert in the room. So you have to think, how are you going to get them engaging with each other too? And that it's digital, but you have to think differently about how to build those social pieces in.
I'm going to pick up on that and go with the question that we've got in the Q&A right now from Melanie White, which is a great question. I love this question so much, I'm adding it to my course for tomorrow, which is, I'm wondering how we as teachers listen in an online class. How do we listen? And what are the, that's a really rich question. John, why don't you go ahead?
I guess my first reaction is talk less, right? You know, that, and you know, kidding aside, we have this tendency, especially in a synchronous session like this, where we've got video, where if I'm the teacher, I'm the expert, I'm supposed to be talking most of the time. And the students might be down here in the chat somewhere, you know, putting in comments or whatever, questions if they have them. But really giving that control over and making it an interactive experience, allowing students to participate in that. And that means that I'm not just giving them content all the time. We're discussing something, or we're asking for analysis, or we're asking students to compare things or to critique things. And to do that, you can do that in a video, you know, synchronous session, but you can also do that in an online forum. You could also have students participating in Flipgrid, or having them, you know, put content in many different formats. I think the points that Helen made about synchronous versus asynchronous commenting, you know, I was always the introvert, right? And this kind of thing where I have to react to something Dave just said terrifies me. You know, I would much rather read that in a forum post and then spend an hour composing a response to it. And then it's going to be 800 words that nobody's ever going to read. But I will know that I've put my best version of that forward. And so as that kid, you know, I flourish in that environment. So I think using a number of different modalities, we get to know our kids and get to know, I keep referring to them as kids. They may not be kids, depending on your context, but we know our learners, because we're interacting them in these different spaces.
And I think one of the pieces there is that to make sure that it's equitable, but it also recognizes those students who do not want to talk on screen and do not want to write because there's risk and there's jeopardy in it. They and honoring those students and still giving them a chance. So it becomes a very, it's an equity piece in terms of, yeah, it's equal, it's not equal, it's equitable. Not everybody gets 5 minutes to talk. Not everybody has to introduce themselves, but everybody who needs to can, and those who it's always invitational, I think. It's that bringing in, drawing in, and knowing the students that are the quiet voices that really might have something to say. So you listen carefully. Yeah, you listen differently. And some of those high listening strategies can be built into the course.
One of the things we encourage our teachers to do, and most of them have embraced this pretty well, is to just connect with every student at least once a week, right? And that's, you know, sometimes that's just virtual office hours and kids are checking in or students are checking in. Sometimes, you know, especially the early elementary level, we have teachers making phone calls to kids, and kids get super, first grader gets super excited when the teacher's on the phone, right? And it's just a 2 minute, how's your week going? And, you know, hey, I was concerned about whatever, or what are you, you know, what are your plans for the weekend, or what? It's just connecting with them on a personal level and just making sure that everybody's okay.
Bonnie, how about you? How do you listen?
I think it depends on whether I'm teaching synchronously or asynchronously, as everyone has noted. But one of the things we haven't done in these synchronous sessions that I do like to do is something like a blank slide or a live slide that allows for people to break that first bit of participation, like active participation rather than just consumption, while not being visible or named, right? Because one of the things about having to take the mic or even participate in the chat is you're making yourself visible. And like, we have students who don't necessarily feel comfortable speaking up in class, breaking that first boundary of engaging publicly in an online space can be super intimidating for people, particularly when they haven't had the chance to get to know each other. And Maha just pointed out, like, it's important for the students to have spaces to get to know each other. So creating spaces for that is an important way of creating listening among the class. I also think that a lot of my online teaching is asynchronous. I do a fair amount with comments and trying to build like participatory assignments where they are the audience for each other's work. And are giving feedback. And I've shared before that I use the RISE model of feedback, that I just share a link with them, but it means that they're not saying, yay, good job. They have to respond to each other with four sentences that give a little bit of reflection, a little bit of inquiry. Sometimes it's amazing. Sometimes it's just fair, but just fair is better than everyone going, yay, good job, because no one is sure what to do. And to me, that creates a space for listening. I love the point that Jack brought up in the chat around his online questions board, and that actually a lot of the time students are the ones who are answering those questions for each other. Part of listening is decentering yourself, right? And so finding ways in the online actually allows me to decenter myself more than in a face-to-face classroom. If I go hide behind my desk, I look weird. Go ahead, Dave.
And I'll push back on that just slightly. It's about consciously centering and decentering yourself. As a person who's teaching, sometimes you very much need to center yourself. So
oh, yeah.
Establishing common language amongst a group of people, and you're saying, okay, so for instance, you know, John used the word abundance earlier, which I'm also fond of. And you're saying, okay, but what I mean by abundance, let me spend 5 minutes. I'm going to explain to you what I mean and give you the context and why I think it's important for education. I'm going to take the time right now and I'm going to talk, and you guys want to ask questions in the chat room, that's fine. But I'm going to go ahead for the next 5 minutes and explain this concept. And then when you go and say, now I'd really like to hear from you, when you make those distinctions really crisp, people understand both that, okay, sometimes you're just setting a context, you're the party host and you need to explain the rules. And then some other times it's really time for people to engage. And I find the more that I give permission for me to not listen where I'm just talking, the easier it is for me to then say, okay, now I am listening. And then people understand that distinction. I think that's been really helpful for me as well. Okay, so let's, I'm going to pick up another question. We're getting a lot of the questions rolling through the chat room, which is okay. You did not do what I said, but that's okay. Go ahead, Helen.
I'm going to interrupt and jump on the comment to the question that Melanie threw into the chat about struggling with finding a way to invite the students in. And then she tried Flipgrid and she tried chats and handouts. And sometimes it's really hard. You think that the students aren't engaging and you think that you're losing them. And for me, it's always that personal invitation. So in some cases, yeah, you can pick up the phone and you can call them. With online learners at the higher ed space, no, that's not particularly appropriate necessarily, nor will you have their phone number. But there are ways to make sure that they know that you care and that you are inviting them into the conversation. So I have some students who don't necessarily, they're not active in the learning space. I use Bitmojis, emojis a lot to hook them, and I'll use memes to hook them, and I'll send them an email, and I'll send them another one 2 days later, and I'll send them a third one if I haven't heard from them yet, and I said, I just want to talk to you, let's set up a time to talk, and it'll be some kind of humor thrown in. So you keep reaching out and inviting them in, and finally I got the conversation done, and it was so productive and so worthwhile that from then on, there was more engagement from that particular student. So yeah, just keep inviting, find out from them what it is they want to do and how they want to engage.
So and I think people have the right not to join also, right? Like we can invite people in to be part of the social presence part of what we're building as our learning. And if people choose not to join, they have that right.
So I just want to roll that forward with another question that came in a while ago in the chat room, which is, I'd love to hear from all of you on some strategies to engage students from day one online. And I mean, how do you sculpt things at the front end of this? So for those people, I know people are running out to the end right now, but if you have advice for people who are starting up, we've got faculty who start teaching on Tuesday. So what are the things that you think that they need to do at the very beginning, that smile issue to some degree? What are the things that you think about with the advice you give people or the things you do yourself to get that started from day one? Go ahead, John.
Yeah, I mean, we've talked a lot about smiling and just developing the relationship with people and trying to get that caring, empathetic relationship going. But I think starting out, I think is really helpful just to be consistent in how you're doing things and how your expectations are structured, and you know, okay, we're gonna drop new assignments on Tuesdays and they're gonna be due on, you know, Mondays or whatever, and just establishing some sort of routine. I know that, you know, in early elementary the kids love routine, right? It's we're going to line up and go to, you know, music class, or we're going to, you know, every day at the beginning of the day, we're going to do our lunch counts, and we're going to go through the weather, and we're going to do, you know, whatever your routine is. They really thrive at knowing what that routine is and how they can predict what's going to happen and when things are going to happen and how that's going to work. And I think that's true for learners of any age in an online environment, especially where you have all of these things and some of these tools are completely new and you're linking out to other resources, and it can be very overwhelming. So I think if we can structure that and do it in a way that is predictable and consistent, make sure that we are reiterating what our expectations are, that helps people engage. You know, they generally, I think, want to succeed and they want to participate, and we just need to give them good ways to do that.
Bonnie? Very first day. Okay, you're still muted. Go ahead, Helen.
Okay.
I was in the chat, sorry. I'm trying to follow up with Brian here in the chat.
I was thinking about the very first activity that you want them to engage in has to be something that'll just hook them in a neat way. I always use, or have used frequently, my shoe selfie story as a hook. So they take a picture of their favorite footwear, and then they tell their story as if they were the footwear, describing the person who wears that piece, and we get some of the most interesting stories, but you get to know the students and what their passions are, and whether they're, you know, sports related or they just kick back and share they like to travel with, and it's a nice way for them to get to know each other, and it's outside of share your picture and why are you taking this course.
So we have another question that was the very, very first question that came into the chat room from my good buddy, Jane, who has had the terrible misfortune of having been trained by me before. Sorry, Jane. I just thought it would be good to go back to that question now, because we've got about 10 minutes, and I definitely did not do the calculation to wonder if we've actually got 100 years of online learning experience in this chat room right now, but it's pretty close. If you have a couple of things, and the question is about professional development. So Jane is saying that they're not reopening this year, but they're thinking about what kind of professional learning opportunities we need for our teachers between now and September. We've all been in this conversation 100 times. We've never had as many people ask us our opinion about it, frankly, as probably we had in the last 5 or 6 weeks. But we've all been in this conversation. So if you had an opportunity to, I'm going to ask you two pieces. The first one is, what kind of formal professional development would you recommend, and what, like for a system or whatever, like what should you work on? And the other piece is, what kind of informal piece would you recommend? So what kind of formal professional development and what kind of informal professional development? Because I think you need both. John, you're nodding your head. Why don't you go first?
I want to start with informal, and informal, I think, starts with reflection, right? Because we've had this period of a couple months, and I think most people are in a situation where you kind of got thrown into, hey, all that stuff that you were doing in a classroom, you're doing it online starting tomorrow. So good luck with that, right? And so we had this wonderful time when we had no expectations. We could do whatever we wanted, and we couldn't fail. Like, testing is canceled, exams are canceled, grades are canceled, do whatever you want. So that's what we did. And so it's, how did that go? What did you try? What worked well? What didn't work? What do you definitely not want to do in the fall? And I think starting with that at the teacher level and saying, okay, how did spring go? What do we need to make sure that we don't do or we do, as we go forward, I think is a really important component. I think the other piece that we really should be doing informally is reflecting on what is really important to us instructionally. What do we mean by education? And those are hard questions, and they're questions that we always, have that introductory conversation around in every committee, is like, what are we about? And then we kind of sweep it under the rug and go do the real work. And it always comes back to bite us, right? We're not of one mind on what we mean by grades or assessment or you know, what the teacher's role in learning is. And I think we need to kind of think through that, because it's coming back to bite us a lot, right? If grades are measuring what students are doing and we're using that as an extrinsic motivator, that's fine. But know that the grades are also not going to be, at the same time, they can't be a measure of student achievement. Those are two different things. So you have to decide which of those you're going to do. And that might be at an individual level or it might be at an institutional level. I think on the formal side, what we're trying to do, you know, the spring was about substitution, you know, not to bait Dave with Sammer model, but, you know, looking at substituting what we were doing, you using online tools to try to replicate what we're doing in the classroom. And what we're looking at for fall is the redefinition side, is the other end of the spectrum. It's how do we use online resources to make teaching and learning better or different than it was face-to-face. And so what we're trying to do in my school board is come up with a template that we can give teachers of, these are the things that we need to do for each unit, and take a large piece of instructional goals and narrow that down and find what the most important bits of that are. And, you know, within each of those topics, we're going to come up with two or three things that we're going to try to accomplish within that larger goal. So breaking things down into smaller pieces. So our formal professional development is taking those standards, breaking them down into smaller pieces, putting them into a framework that is pretty consistent across the organization. And then how do we put that in an online environment? So it's all pedagogy. It's very little tool stuff. This is not the time to be adopting a new LMS, as much as we would have loved to have adopted a new LMS like 2 years ago so that we would all be on board with it right now. We can't do that right now. We have to focus on how do we teach kids in this environment.
That sounds simple, equitable, and engaging, John. We approve.
So do I get full marks for that, Dave?
Yeah, you get an A.
One thing I want to piggyback on what John said, the pedagogy is at the core, I think, of any professional development or faculty development. I was in a conversation just earlier today around faculty development around this as well, because one of the things that, you know, we see an opportunity in higher ed to build learners, students' digital literacies with a potential move to fall online. But, and I think Mahabali in Egypt has left, but my very favorite skills versus literacies distinction that I know of was written by her a few years ago. And skills are, as she describes it, sort of like the things that you know how to do, but the literacies are how you make meaning out of it. Kind of like being able to decode, like CAT is cat, but what does a cat mean? What does a cat signify in culture? How do you make meaning out of that concept? And if it's hard to teach literacies that we don't have. So I think some of this needs to focus on building on the digital literacies that educators, no matter how not competent you feel, work with the strengths that you've got, and helping people to, again, meta identify what those strengths are, map them to the goals that they have for learning, and then find a couple of simple things that they could start with. Get fancy later, maybe don't at all, but definitely start with, because everybody actually does have some place that they can begin.
How are you, Helen?
And I'm just going to piggyback that comment to what Stephanie wrote in the chat around recognizing the component of failure and knowing that we're all going to fail, and some of us are going to fail in dramatic fashion, not saying Zoom bombing experiences with hindsight, but I think being able to share those failures with each other in some way, even if it's a coffee conversation over Zoom with your colleagues, or whether you blog about them. Some of the best learning that I've done informally is by reading really succinct and really deep blogs that people have written. And that then leads me down a rabbit hole to find something else. Informally, looking at things like the eCampus Ontario educator model and picking something that you can work away at a little bit at a time so that you don't feel like you have to do it all or learn it all, but you set a plan or a goal for yourself to try and engage in some way differently, digitally, that will move you forward and allow your students to move forward. For formal PD, I know a lot of universities have learning systems in place. A lot of faculty don't tend to use those, and you know, it's a nice opportunity, a nice time to take that stuff on and do that.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm going to build a little bit on Stephanie's comment too. I think the best thing you can do for faculty, for teachers or faculty before September is set them up to fail in some way. The thing that we have had the most success with in the course that we're teaching, the first week, against my better instincts, we took it really easy, we took it really safe, and it didn't work because the risk wasn't high enough and they didn't have an experience that, it's funny because the participants themselves have complained. They're like, you have five people in here facilitating 25. This is not an experience that's in any way gonna look like what we have. And we're like, okay. So the next week, we just threw them to the wolves and we sent them off and we let them struggle and we watched the breakout rooms and the synchronous thing that we're doing. We could see that they were struggling. And we're talking ourselves down. We're like, let them struggle, let them struggle, let them struggle. And then 7, 8, 9, 10 minutes in, it's a long time, they started getting it, they started working together, they started figuring it out. The reason I say that is our faculty, are, especially after week one, are coming out of this course with a real understanding of what it's like to be a learner and what it's like to not know what's going on and what it's like to receive that email that explains things clearly on time, right? And what it's like to not get it and what it's like to, we had a faculty member a couple days ago write back to me and go, I clicked the wrong button. I wasn't able to finish the test on Monday. Now, that test is a feedback questionnaire, but we set it up in the test module in the LMS. And she's like, I would have failed that test. I'm like, uh-huh. Yeah, you would have failed that test. It sucks, doesn't it? And that experience is one that, as a teacher, you need, I'm winking at Jane Haskell here because I did this terrible thing to her when I was teaching her a couple of years ago. You need to put them in a position that's difficult so that they understand what that student experience is going to be like. There is nothing like understanding how hard it is to be a student who has not had something explained well to them to make you feel like you should take that extra 5 minutes to explain it better, right? To make you go, I'm gonna walk all the way through this process and make sure I understand that I'm giving the right information so that the students are gonna be able to understand on the other end. So I'd say set yourself up with some stuff that's uncomfortable. And if I'm designing training, I'm making it hard. That's maybe not popular feedback, but that's how I feel about it.
Can I jump in with one last thing? Because Christine, who was actually in an online course of mine years back, just asked about what if she's not using video? And frankly, not using video is a great thing, Christine. There is a lot of encouragement right now to rethink the idea of online means A, synchronous, and B, synchronous means video. Synchronous can mean different ways of engaging. Right now, yes, we do have the video element of this, but we are also all in the same space in the chat. And sometimes what I've done is set up like Q&As that are just text in different spaces that allow still people to engage in real time if everyone is in the same time zone, has the same freedom, whatever. But there are all kinds of ways to do things without video, and it is much more equitable, frankly, to design as much as you can without video. Think about the times when there might be real value in having some of that face-to-face contact, maybe making it asynchronous video, so you're making video of yourself, putting it up, sharing it, even having students do back, if that's something that you really want, is that facial element. Yeah, it'd be great to send the first SEE webinar to Lecce. I'm not sure that he's it's on his radar. I'm getting that sense. For those of you who aren't in Ontario, Lecce is our Minister of Education, who does not appear to be, he last week was pushing the idea that now, because there is pushback from parents, that this is all kind of a little catch as catch can, let's all go to synchronous video teaching, which of course isn't going to work. And when you consider families with multiple kids in classrooms, multiple grades, and maybe one device, if they have the one device, timing that, project managing that, all of those pieces. I know there are districts that are doing it. I've been super pleased that Ontario is not thus far, and still, knock on wood, hopeful that they don't go that route. Stephanie, please do tweet the videos to him. I encourage you. I noticed it's the top of the hour, so I want to say thank you so much for all the really great questions and engagement today. And what I love about this is so many people, everyone has expertise that they're sharing in the chat, and I appreciate it. I hope we got to at least some of the core of the questions of what makes digital different. Helen and John, thank you so much for bringing your years of experience to the folks who are here today. And we will be posting this recording at k12.olia.ca. Have a great day.